DOJ's announcement of the foiled Iranian terror plot on the Saudi Arabian ambassador to the U.S. comes at a time, as we were just discussing, when Eric Holder has been subpoenaed for the Fast and Furious operation, a scandalous event that put U.S. firearms, military-grade weapons, in the hands of Mexican drug cartels. So what can we make of all this? For big picture analysis, we also turn to former CIA operative and chief of the Bin Laden unit, Michael Scheuer. Michael, it's always a pleasure. Welcome back to Freedom Watch.
Thank you, Judge.
Why do you think the Attorney General is hyping this so-called threat from Iran? Why do you think it was announced when it was announced? And does any of this make sense to you?
Well, I think, first of all, Ms. Miller's description of the operation is correct. It's like a Marx Brothers movie, but without the Marx Brothers, just some dummies they recruit from the street. I think one thing we need to keep in mind is that the performance of the FBI and DOJ in the area of terrorism has been pretty pathetic over the past couple years. They may have jumped at something because it gave an appearance of actually being successful, but really it turns out to be just another sting, Judge. This is another counterterrorism operation at the end of the day that lured somebody into running it, apparently.
All right. This is basically a claim by the federal government that it protected us from harm that was never really there and never really threatening us to begin with. But it has that added twist, Michael, of involving the government of Iran. So let me ask you this. Who would want to create the impression that we need to engage in military activity, which a lot of the neocons demanded before the ink was even dry on this criminal complaint, against Iran?
Oh, the only people that would benefit from that would be the Israelis and the Saudis. And I think if I was looking at a counterintelligence operation to decide where this information came from, I'd be very interested to see if I could find an Israeli hand or a Saudi hand. Because in the long run, Judge, both Israel and Saudi Arabia are much more dangerous enemies to the United States than the Iranians are. The Iranians are a third-rate military power that we could handle very easily. But, you know, the Congress is crazy for war with Iran. Listen to Senator Graham and Senator McCain and Joe Lieberman. They're owned by the Israelis. The Saudis are very influential. So when you look at these kind of things, you have to ask, who would benefit from the war? The Israelis and the Saudis would love to see our money and our young men and women being killed to fight their enemies in Iran.
All right, you have engaged professionally in counterintelligence to enhance the security of the United States during much of your adult life. Tell me, Michael, could this be a case in which the American government, in which the Justice Department, was played like a fiddle by foreign entities? It thought it was running the case. It thought it was in control of it. But in reality, these people that were involved were not under their control, but were under the control of someone who wanted to foment animosity between Iran and the United States.
I don't think it's impossible, Judge. I, of course, don't have the information to say that. But when you look at the bottom line, who this benefits if it leads to military action against Iran, it only benefits the Israelis and Saudi Arabia. And there's a precedent for it. We've already fought two wars against Iraq in favor of Israeli interests and Saudi interests. So we're always being pushed to get our people killed for their interests. So I think it could happen another time. Why not?
Got it. Michael Scheuer, it's a pleasure, no matter how gloomy these things are that we talk about. Thanks for joining us.
Thank you, Judge.
What we need to stand up and say is not only did they attack the USS Liberty, they did 9/11. They did it. I have had long conversations over the past 2 weeks with contacts at the Army War College, at Headquarters Marine Corps, and I've made it absolutely clear in both cases that it is 100% certain that 9/11 was a Mossad operation, period. First, a disbelief, and what I show them immediately afterwards is an interview with a demolitions expert named Danny Jawenko, and it shows the third building at the World Trade Center going down. And they look at that, and I said, now you understand that if one of the buildings was wired for demolition, all of them were wired for demolition. And that's it. That's the tipping point. Getting into arguments about who was flying what and where they were and whether there was nanothermite, those things are true, but they're incidental. the thing that's necessary is to tell people three buildings went down, the third was not hit by a plane, it was wired for controlled demolition, therefore all of them were wired for controlled demolition, and at that point the reaction is rage. First disbelief and then rage. 9/11 has led directly to 60,000 Americans dead and wounded. God knows how many hundreds of thousands of people in other countries that we've killed or wounded or made homeless. This is an open wound. And what Americans need to understand is they did it. They did it. And if they do understand that, Israel's going to disappear. Israel will flat ass disappear from this earth. I sent a film to one of my colleagues, and it basically had Americans grieving over their dead, coming back. And I showed one of them, it was a woman, just wrenched by grief, you know, over her dead soldier. And I said, you know, if Americans ever know that Israel did this, they're going to scrub them off the earth, and they're not going to give a rat's ass what the cost is. They are not going to care. The first thing, Mark, is astonishment. They didn't know. They truly didn't know. And these are not unintelligent people. They really didn't know. And the next statement is rage. Real rage. The Zionists are playing this as truly an all-or-nothing exercise. Because if they lose this one, if the American people ever realize what happened, they're done. The military has not been bought. The military is loyal, but it has not been bought. And if it ever understands this, really, really deeply understands this, and this is what I got when I put some of these things to the Army War College and to Headquarters Marine Corps, I mentioned to a contact at Headquarters Marine Corps, I said, you know they did 9/11. And it was, you don't mean it. I said, absolutely. And if they ever understand that, these people are history.
Completely shocked. Unbelievable.
Right, that's the view from the Palestinian side. Joining me now here in the BBC World Studio is the former Israeli Prime Minister Ehud Barak, who's in London at the moment. Mr. Barak, welcome to BBC World. First, your reaction, having heard what's happened. At least four planes have been hijacked, and there may be more.
The world will not be the same from today on. I don't know who is responsible. I believe we will know in 12 hours. Bin Laden sits in Afghanistan. There is a source of terror.
Who else can you identify, though? Because we're not saying he's responsible for this necessarily.
No, we don't say that he's responsible. Every simple step, crossing borders or going on a plane or on a ship, will become more complicated. It's a time to launch a operational, concrete war against terror, even if it takes certain pains from the routine activities of our normal society. This is the time to deploy a globally concerted effort led by the United States, the UK, Europe, and Russia against all sources of terror consistently along 6 or 10 years. Iran, Iraq, Libya, North Korea. This is the only way. Without this clarity of purpose, there will be no world order. No world order.
I would like to let you know that thanks to you, I watched Jesse Ventura's documentaries dealing with the September 11th attacks conspiracy theory, and I would like to call your attention to a detail that the research team may have overlooked. It's something that jumped out at me when I watched the documentary, namely that's the ownership of Hangar 17, where the only known evidence from 9/11 still in existence is locked away from public scrutiny.
Yes, now, so Giuliani signed a mayoral decree that no one can ever get it and that he, after being out of office, controls it. How does a mayor give himself power and control and basic ownership over something after he leaves?
Very interesting. Well, the thing that jumped out at me was this. When Jesse's camera team viewed the building from a certain angle, Hangar 17 in JFK Airport has a prominent unfaded billboard that says Tower Air. Now, anyone can go and look in YouTube and they can see it there. Tower Airlines was an Israeli airline that went bankrupt in 2000. And it's none other than that building, Hangar 17, that housed Tower Air's then brand new corporate headquarters.
I did not know that. Somebody should write up an article about that, and we'd post it at Infowars.com.
This is my question is this. Why does 9/11 evidentiary material that would provide clues such as the absence or presence of super thermite or other explosive materials in the dust from the blast sit there for safekeeping in the former executive headquarters of a 10-year defunct Israeli front organization that contracted heavily for the U.S. Defense Department, and it still has an unfaded sign hanging on the building?
Sir, write it up, and we'll post it. You know, get the video clip or links to it or screenshots.